Faculty of Art and Design. I would like to welcome Mr. Thomas Milo, who came from the Netherlands. Mr. Milo is from is an independent scholar. He's also an entrepreneur. He's a member of the Unicode Consortium. He studied Slavic, Turkish languages, Quranic and Classical Arabic, as well as other dialects. He also helped, he set up Decotype and invented smartphone technology, which became the proof of concept of OpenType. He's also active in the field of Arabic font technology since the 80s, with a focus on modeling previously irreproducible Arabic script. There is also one important point, that Thomas was also a member of the UNIFIL in the 80s, so he was in Lebanon during that time. He was also as actually a part of the Dutch battalion. So that's a very brief, actually, introduction of Mr. Milo, because he has an extremely long experience. He'll tell you more about it, and please welcome Mr. Thomas.
I got a last moment idea to give you a brief introduction about Decotype. Thank you. I got a last moment idea to give you a brief introduction of Decotype. This is it. This is a very compact way of preparing you for my lecture. I know that I'm the guest of the graphic design department, but graphic design is actually just a small overlap with what I'm doing. And maybe the images that I'm showing here express the essence of the overlap. Here you have in the center an illegible image of a sequence of vertical stubs, which is a caricature of Arabic script, which in old manuscripts could either be Yunashir or Yusayir. And you see I spelled it out here explicitly. And I rendered the full word with the classical Nask shape on the left and on the right for Yusayir, and in the middle in gray, their bare skeletons. I have a second, below in the yellow field, I have a similar example of a caricature of Arabic with four vertical stubs, where on the left you see Tisa and on the right you see Saba. For all clarity, these are not games. The blue one that I just discussed is an actual variation in the transmission of the Quran text. And below is an instance where someone claims that the surah that says Aleha Tisa Tashr, that it is actually Aleha Seba Asher, which in which case Asher is an old Semitic word for gate, and he says it has nothing to do with 19 angels, but it, which is the conventional reading, but with seven gates of hell. And in this particular case, I was surprised that both the pros and the cons, and you can imagine that a lot of people would object to changing the interpretation of the Quran, that nobody had the common sense to point out that this confusion cannot occur, because we do not know any Quran manuscripts that writes in caricatures. They write Tisa and Seba in such a way that you cannot confuse them. They raise the initial stub when it's Tisa, and they raise the fourth stub when it's Seba. The confusion does not exist. And the point is that without knowledge of grammar, of the grammar of script, you can miss essential arguments in scientific discourse. But it is also essential in the building of fonts. Fonts, typefaces are normally, certainly for Arabic, are adaptations of Arabic for technical environments that were never made for Arabic. So you could call them Arab hostile environments. Arabic is designed for technology instead of technology for Arabic. So the moment you would start to make technology for Arabic, which is what I've been doing, then it becomes interesting to understand how Arabic is structured. By the way, here is the example of another example of the confusion, Lisan Laisa, where the second image where the six sequence of stubs would be ambiguous, but the actual instances in the text are completely different. And again, this is a fascinating existing example. You see the old images of two lines of transmission of the Quran, where in one case the copyist has written Laisa, and then in the other case Lisan. It raises the issue do we really have an oral transmission? If words like Lisan and Laisa that sound completely different can be confused. But anyway, and you see also in later styles like Nasr, where we these forms cannot really be confused. This whole collision with scholarship starts with a playful history of pushing Arabic script rendering to the limits. This is all looking at Arabic with the eyes of a child and with the toys for boys, like typewriters with electrical machines, computers. How can you change the glyphs so that you change a very boring Arabic typewriter into something that writes Ruqa, which we actually were able to do? And why did we? We only did it with the meme, because the meme is the metaphor for the problem. The meme is, of course, the one that only connects in a cascading way. And it is the one that if you can take the meme, you can basically take the hurdle and you can get the rhythm back in a basmala, like here in the Nasr. And indeed, we did that. And now let me not stay too long with this introduction. Well, a few more words. This particular invention, where we created a smartphone that could do Ruqa, and here you see side by side a handwritten Ruqa and a decotype Ruqa. The decotype is on the right and the handwritten is on the left, for all clarity. It was licensed by Apple, it was licensed by Microsoft in the first half of the 1990s. It became an object in all copies of Microsoft Office. And it gave Microsoft the proof of concept that fonts could be much more interesting than just size fits all. Then we developed eventually something that is now known as Tasmim, where we, and this is very brief, where we have the concept of the complete merger or integration of the letters that make up a letter block into a unique form without using ligatures at all. A ligature is a mechanical solution to deal with the fusion of Arabic letters. The fusion here is symbolized by the golden outline. Everything together becomes a new thing, like sugar added to hot coffee. The two components are no longer themselves. They are together. They become a new thing. For the sake of clarity, we gave the original letters that went into this particular mixture the Google colors, to symbolize the searchability. You know, Google, of course, is the searching concept by par excellence. And it gives, in other words, we could do this while we maintain the identity of the letters. And on top of that, we discovered that Arabic has what we now call calligraphic parameters, change parameters. There's the well-known stretch, or kashida, or med, as it was originally called in Arabic. The fact that it is now called tatwil, or what else do we have, kashida, actually signals that most people do not read the original information about Arabic script culture. Within the same style, there are many different ways of doing this. Now, let me stop here. It's only just a brief introduction that I have more or less accidentally entered the world of script design, of typography. On the other hand, an interest for historical linguistics and the origin of texts. To keep things more confusing, I added at the last moment two images which I thought I owed to you. I was indeed in Lebanon in the 1980s, and public relations section of the Dutch army created this poster. And of course, we had our own military sense of humor. That you, can you imagine that in the mayhem of the South, we made it a point to have our boots polished, because that's military humor. Now back to the point. The subject is script grammar. Well, anybody who doesn't have the Nokia tune at least indicates that he is technically literate. We have here the letter Y, and I repeated it many times in order to expose its beauty. And at the same time, I transliterate it with the English letter Y, so that is the answer Y. And my whole talk is basically about the letter Y in the early form of Arabic. So here you see a whole page full of two base letters. It could be a Qaf and an Alif Maksura. I'm actually not interested in what they are today with the dots. I'm only looking at the shapes as they occur in the manuscript, where no dots and vowels were used. Or if they were used, they were used occasionally. So this transliterates the image, and I'm showing you some more to bring you in the right wavelength. This is another group. I'm leaving you to guess for a sec what this could be. And yes, this is it. It could be Shay. This is another group. You have to get used to the fact that I'm using the letter C for transliterating the Saad. It's actually the convention on the Apple keyboard, in case you use the QWERTY variant of the Apple keyboard, so it's not such a mad idea. And also, the letter Ein is typed with the E. So all these words have in common that they end in the letter Y. The letter Y, not necessarily the sound Y. Anybody, do you have any idea what this is? Sabili, yeah. Well, if you attended my earlier lectures, you would know. Tajalni, yajalni. Well, this is interesting to dwell on for a moment, just to get you in the right frequency. If you know what it is, it's yajalni or tajalni, but the Latin transliteration is still a generic B, a generic G, generic E, an L, a generic B, and Y. Because I'm studying it only from the point of view of form. And you have been looking at images taken from a manuscript that was found in Sana'a after an earthquake damaged the Grand Mosque. And this is one of the most dramatic images of in what state these manuscript fragments turned up. They had been trashed. It is called a Geneza, like a Quran grave. Over hundreds and hundreds of years, spent Qurans were not just trashed, they were given an honorable place, and in this case, in the construction of the roof, they served as heat isolation of the mosque. So they had another 1,000 years of exposure to heat. And then, with help of UNESCO money, these 30,000 Quran fragments were all rigidly reorganized into a library. They were cataloged. And of course, guess who you bring in for these things? The Germans. So it was a team of German scholars who worked on this. And this particular manuscript that is now in the Darul Makhtutat, DAM, was identified as having 15 lines of the page, each of them 15 centimeters wide. Can you imagine that this was only this big? It's just, you can keep it in your hand. And it's therefore cataloged as DAM Delta Alpha Mike 15152. And here's some more images, because one of the scholars who was sent out from Germany was also a fervent photographer. He brought a very good color camera, and he made a limited number of color slides of these manuscripts. All the other 30,000 are only known, they're all in black and white. And that is, in a way, completely stupid, because color in early Arabic is graphemic. It carries information. If you do not preserve the color information, you do not fully record what was on the original parchment. You see? This is, by the way, that it is the full slide, you can see from the upside down lettering inside each of these photographs. Like here is, you see still 2, 1, 5, 1, 5. So he set some counter in his camera to keep the number of the identity of the manuscript automatically recorded. So this is the whole picture, which means that to identify the precise corresponding passage in the modern Quran, it's not trivial, because we have only a couple of half lines. See that? And you know that even versed readers of Arabic have trouble immediately reading this kind of script. How the hell do you, with all respect, how the heaven, do you identify this? You see, this is the same, from the same series. So one day in the mail arrived a box with 140 of these slides, with a letter from the German professor or a scholar who made these photos, saying, "Could you please make a font for me from these pictures?" And what I'm going to talk about now is, how do you make a font out of two shoeboxes with slides that are completely deranged in terms of focus? They are all, he followed his whim when he made the photos. He made nice close-ups of details, losing the context. And so after scanning them, I ended up with a virtual slide sorter of this, with this kind of collection, where the software that I used gave, for instance, an automatic number to it as a file name. So this detail was given this file name. So I got really very difficult material to work with. Now what I did is, and that's part of what I want to explain to you, I developed a technique to turn the Quran into a thesaurus of Arabic script information. And in this exercise, I hope you get the gist of it. First, I looked at a group of letters that I guessed would be the least frequent in general. So I would never try to identify this fragment using Alif and Lam, because these are too frequent to be helpful. But I thought this would be helpful. Now I happen to, I transliterate them as what I see, an F and a Wow, Fa or a Kaf. I'm not even trying to read it, because you can make very strange mistakes. And then I see two letter blocks, so I separate, I indicate the space with a real space. I'm not going to try to read words, I'm only looking at the letter blocks. Then I flip to InDesign, which runs Arabic here. And what I created is a document that has Arabic and English, Arabic and Arabic side by side. The left-hand side has the modern form of the Quran, where everybody knows exactly how you read it and what it means. On the right-hand side, I have a paleo-orthographic normalization. I have taken out all the detail of the modern Quran that no two Qurans agree about. And there is so much difference between the Qurans that in the end you only need a handful of Latin letters to record the information that is common between all the Qurans. And that, in fact, is wonderful, how stable and consistent the remaining skeleton really is. Now, what I do is, in this skeleton text, I type now the thing that I identified, FW space FHM, and replace it with the same, plus color. So I find 13 instances in the whole Quran, which will now light up in color, that have this particular letter group. Now, I find 13 too much, I need only one. So I'm looking for a second anchor in this image, and I decided for this one. It's a generic B, a generic Ein, I'm not yet sure what it is, and a generic B. I'm ignoring, by the way, the Aleph, because I have already learned that an Aleph is not a reliable element to search with. So in my search argument, I'm starting with a space, indicating that the first letter was disconnected, and then I type BEB, and I'm not typing a space behind it. And then I'm replacing that with the same plus color in this document. So now I get 288. That's too much work for me. But by chance, I see already light up one of these letterblocks quite close to the one that I just colored. And if we go back to the... So I mark it with yellow. This is an interesting area. I'm scanning quickly through the text, looking using the one that had only 30 positions. And whenever I see two of them close by, nearby each other, I mark the whole area in yellow. So I find three areas out of 288 where the second search argument is close to the first search argument. And remember, we had this image, we had FWFHM, and close by we had VEB. So we're very close to identifying this. With a normal concordance or searching system, it would be impossible to find it so quickly. Now, to nail it down, I discovered that I'm looking for a final group, and I'm settling for this one. I'm now taking the courage to use make a bold move. I use two letter blocks at once. Or again, I have now a generic B, a generic F, a W, and a lamb. I think as speakers of Arabic, we know that this is Nakul or Yakul. Now, the people who worked on this text, and this is a little of a sidebar to my argument, you see the little red marker here? It corresponds with a dot in modern Arabic. So it says Nakul. So we say. But do you see the two green ones here? It corresponds to two dots in modern Arabic. It's Yakul. So in fact, this single word says Nakul and Yakul at the same time. And in the colors it says green is wrong, right is correct.
Red
is correct, green is wrong. Yeah, they use different, they would have been a disaster with modern traffic lights. But so the code is the other way around. Red is correct, green is wrong. And guess what? The modern Quran has Yakul in that position. So that's just for your excitement. and what this also means, if you're familiar with the practice of text edition, if in the academic world, we have important texts in Greek like Homer, we have Tacitus in Latin. We know these texts by surviving manuscripts, but we also know that these manuscripts are very late. There is a whole intermittent chain of transmission that is lost. So we have a couple of dispersed manuscripts that are not agreeing on every detail. And then the text edition that results from the comparison gives you the text that both manuscripts, or all manuscripts agree upon, plus at the bottom a system of notes, of annotation, which is called an apparatus criticus, a critical machine, the critical apparatus. And what you see here, the two colored markings around the word, are actually an ancient Islamic critical machine. The scholars who worked on these texts, they knew that they were not aware, they were not certain how to read it, and they indicated exactly as we would do it today in scholarship. We know the black indicates this is certain, and the colors indicate we have diversions. Anyway, that's also why I have only BFWL. The other ones I cannot use, and that's why my searching machine works on the Latin transliterations, because there are no Arabic letters that have an N and a Y at the same time. They don't exist. Okay, so I'm searching with that thing, replacing again with color, and now I find 75 Yakul or Nakul instances. So I go back to the one with 13, that's my best guess. So 13 is doable, And now I need to go to the only look at the yellow areas and find a yellow area where there are three highlighted groups inside. And here is one. For all certainty, I go to the third one because we had three areas that would meet our requirements. There's only one, so I go back to the one where I found it. Now I know exactly what I'm looking at. So I have this vague photograph, and I have now a precise location in the Quran. The only thing that's missing, the point of entry of the text. I see an elephant, a generic ba. I look at the Quran here, and here is an elephant, a ba, that meets my requirements. And now I know it's page 528 in the 1924 Cairo edition. The only candidate to be used for this, and I'll explain you why. Here is line number 10, and it is word number 2 in the traditional, in the modern traditional edition. I call this the Cairo grid. All earlier Qurans have the text as a moving target. It always moves to different pages. And the later Qurans that are now produced in Saudi Arabia are stable only as far as the surah number at the end of each page spread. But from page spread to page spread, the lines meander freely. You are never sure where the word is located. The only Quran that gives you 100% coordinate position is the Cairo 1924 Quran. So I use that as a grid system. And now I have a file name technique because I simply use the point of entry and the point of exit. The point of exit is then the next page. I found something here, which I can read as lam and ba and ba. The next could be a lam or an alif, but I'm not looking at it, but I have already enough information to locate the whole thing, because this is what I found. So if you now take the Cairo grid file that I use to work on these slides, I have a parallel column that gives me the conventional text and a transliterated column that I use for searching. If I now color with the stars the text on the slide, and you see the slide begins here with an alif. The alif is here, then there is a ba, then something that's falkhum, falkihim, just min falkihim, stops here, then we have a gap, then we have wayakul, which is here, and then dhu. You see, everything that's on the slide is now painted into the Quran. Why would I want to do that? And I'm getting there in the next bit. I am going to harvest, I'm going to build a database of all the information that I have in these images so that I can use it to analyze the script. So gradually domesticating a shoebox of deranged photographs into something that becomes a gold mine of information about Arabic script. So each time, this is another photograph. Remember, there were photographs that had a whole page? Well, this is a whole uninterrupted stretch of text. So that's good. And this is another photograph of something that has only a margin. And then, after harvesting these letter blocks, I get them in a spreadsheet. I don't even need to know at the original Arabic anymore. I can sort them according to any principle, and it brings out, like wildfire, to all the patterns and the paradigms that are existing in Arabic script. And then each time I am curious about a particular phenomenon, it gives me a number. For instance, 386, it's the page, 11 is the line. Then I gave all the slides file names that indicate precisely which area they cover, so I have immediately an image that explains to me how a certain letter group is built. So I sorted, for instance, on available in the document Sana. I'm now sorting it. Remember script grammar Y. I'm only looking at the letter Y. So I'm sorting them with a simple spreadsheet trick from the final letter. So all the words that contain Y, Brock right to left. And now I have all the words that end in Y in view. And it's a handful of pages. So it's page 1, page 2. And just imagine how much work it would have been to try visually to locate all these instances of Y. I haven't even looked at them. I only took the point of entry, point of exit. I gambled that it is more or less corresponding to the modern Quran, which is usually the case. In some cases, you discover fascinating divergences from the standard text. But that's not what I'm looking for. I'm creating a structure that allows me to milk or to squeeze out of the Quran the last bit of information about Arabic script. Now, why would I be so confident to do this? Because I discover in over years that Arabic script is extremely consistent. And for instance, it's very easy to show that with images from this particular manuscript. I have the letter group Ayn, Mim, Ye. I got it in a close-up, so Dr. Pouin, who made these pictures, focused on one particular word, but then I found the same letter block in many different other slides, but at a lower resolution. And you see here that within a certain tolerance, they're all practically identical. It is as if they had been stamping these images. So people have been writing them, but the eventual result looks like typography. And I apply a concept from linguistics to explain the phenomenon. In language, you have a concept introduced by de Saussure, a Swiss linguist in the 19th century. He speaks of langue and parole. Langue is the common consensus between speakers about a particular language, and parole is the actual speech of individual French or Russian or Dutch speakers. And here you see that the ideal or the langue of Ayn, Mim, Ye is reproduced with minimal variation each time that he writes this particular letter block. Another aspect is that I discover something that I've never seen described. Here you see a letter group Kaf, Ye, and this is a letter group Sad, yeah, and these should be very similar because the difference in this early Arabic between Sad and Kaf is very, very small. It's really only the opening here, or the absence or the presence of an opening at the left-hand side. But somehow, the combination of Kaf and yeah and Sad and yeah is dramatically different. It's very, very legibly different, to put it in a more realistic form. So Kaf, yeah, and Sad, yeah. What you are seeing here is, in fact, a mechanism that you could describe as horizontal and vertical allographs. Allograph is a word borrowed from linguistics again, where you have, when the same sound has different variations in context, predictable variations for the same phoneme, you call these variations allophones. And here you have the same letter that has predictable, hopefully predictable variations for the same function, you call them allographs. Now, before I understand how this works, I collect all the images that have the horizontal allograph. So I have this one, I have this one. You see, the script is so unbelievably consistent that I can produce a whole series of such images. These are, in fact, all the significant cases of horizontal yeah. Now I discovered that this is bet yeah. I discovered that if you add one more bet to this group, the yeah is no longer horizontal, it's vertical. In fact, the whole effect is narrower, so more letters, less width, which is also something you would not expect. So we have horizontal and vertical yes. Here you see a nice contrast, and now I'm going to give you some more vertical yes. A lam ba or lam noon. This is the whole thing is a lam, a generic jim, a generic sin, a generic ba, and a yeah. Here is one, I'm in front. Here you have Ba, Ein, Lam, Ye. And in fact, gradually you get an image that if you have been thinking about why is this Ye vertical, each time you have a vertical Ye, the previous letter ends in a vertical pen stroke. So let's take a look at that here. Oh, here's not a vertical pen stroke, it seems. So let's take a view at what we collected so far. Now, everyone here has a vertical pen stroke except Mim Ein. So you see, all of them, the penultimate letter ends in a vertical pen stroke and therefore forces Ye to continue in vertical direction. That is my explanation. Well, if that to stay in line with that explanation, the consequence is that this is not the last pen stroke. The last pen stroke must have been this one. That is trying to bring some order in chaos. Now, the problem is that I do not have enough examples. What I got in the way of photographs, I got the shoeboxes with images. When I project them on the Quran, I get this image. The white area is 827 pages spread out in two blocks of the Cairo 1924 edition. And the spikes in red are the text fragments actually covered by my slides. And the mechanism to get this is very simple. I remember I colored all the text attested on the slides with black against green for not seen. You run a script and you get the data. You have the spreadsheet and then you generate a graphic. So now all of a sudden you see how little it is. So what I commented on that, and then Professor Puyin said, or Dr. Puyin said, look at the website of Birmingham University. They have manuscripts. They have a manuscript in a very similar style, and it may help you to get more information, to glean the rules from the script. So here is the so-called Mingana manuscript collected by a man called Mingana. And this is what his manuscripts look like. And my first impression is that it is slightly different, but it gives me 8.2 coverage. Let me back up 1 second. The green here gives me the additional, it's the same graph, but then after I painted all the text that I found on the Mingana manuscript. While I looked at this, I got some fascinated by the empty space. And it really means that it begs the investigation to more manuscripts. Would the empty space be filled, or will we get more repetition of the space that is covered? What we see basically here is that the two manuscripts are strikingly convergent. And now just in case you don't get the point, if you had two secret intelligence operations in two locations in the world where they receive an email erroneously, and both secret agencies are told to shred the email. And then they put it in a bin that someone had been throwing his chewing gum in. So when they later collect all the shredded documents and empty it in a dumpster, the chewing gum catches from 100% text. In one case, it captures 2%, and in the other case, even more chewing gum. 8% of the original secret document sticks to the side of the office bin. Now, the chance that there is coincidence between the same text is zero. It would really mean that the document was never 100%, but it was maybe no more than 20% or 10%. In other words, anyway, but this is, of course, speculation. This begs investigation. All the old early Quran manuscripts have to be spread on this on this pattern to see if we have an accident or that eventually all the manuscripts add up to 100% coverage of the modern edition. But this doesn't look good. Now here you have the same issue. We have lots of yes here. You see, now things come to fall together. We are talking about typography, but at the same time we are talking about Arabic script structure, you're talking about history of the Middle East, you're talking about how the transmission of manuscripts is tracked. This makes it interesting. So now I am back in my spreadsheet, and now my spreadsheet has a column Foxtrot F and Golf G, indicating the first and the second manuscript. Now I can search on everything that is shared between the manuscripts, and I now see that I have a Sana and a Mengana example for each letter block. I can see how many I have, and I can see where to I know where to find them. Now let's look by the way, this is script grammar. That there is more than just initial middle final isolated, but the rules gradually grow more complicated or more exciting. This is what I found in the second manuscript. So the second manuscript, which is on the outside of the image, has functionally the same things, but visually they're very different. So you would probably, as graphic people, say we cannot add them up. And in fact, most art historians would tend to consider these two manuscripts not related. But I see only stylistic differences for the moment. I see similar grammar because if I compare these in functionality, I discovered that the vertical allograph has a second function to be the tail of the kaf. This is lam, ha, kaf. It's part of the word al-haq. So it doubles, has a double function, but it happens to have exactly the same function with the other shape, the other stylistic variant in the other manuscript. So in both manuscripts, internally, there is a totally analogous use of the same Xadiya-like shape. So I am not too quick to jump to conclusions. And there is another thing. If you look at this horizontal, it has a specific curve, which I call a hairpin, which I discovered doubles also as the tail of the gene in both manuscripts, with each of them with their own specific shapes. And I hope that, that for you as graphic people, this now becomes more exciting. You see that both manuscripts are actually, in the thinking about the script, they are identical. And then the difference between the styles becomes something like performance, whereas the competence behind it seems to be identical. And therefore, at this point, I think I have corroboration for the script grammar that I'm looking for, because I'm not looking for shapes, I'm looking for structures. And here is the calf and the Saad structure, which again is completely analogous, which again reinforces my impression that they are comparable. And I see that all the ones that I found in manuscript A are, when they are present in manuscript B, have the same kind of construction, with the observation that the fa or kaf is a circle that sits on the line, and if it sits, let's say it sits slightly above the line, if it lowers in a way that half of the circle is above and half of the circle is below the line, then it's a meme. And interestingly, the other manuscript, it lifts the whole circle of the fa kaf letter or archigrapheme above the baseline, whereas the meme sits in the position like the fa in this one. So in fact, everything has shifted slightly, but apart from that, it's identical. So you try to find distinctive features and features that you can handle from other perspectives. This one was too vague for me to be useful as evidence if I hadn't had the Cairo grid. I know exactly what it is supposed to be, and if I look at it again, I see that I actually have my hand, have it in my hands. There is a vertical stroke here, there is a vertical stroke here with damage, then there is here, this whole construction is the head, and then you have the horizontal leaving. And even the mechanism where ba is horizontally constructed, whereas double ba is vertically constructed, is completely present. So there's lots and lots of similarity between the manuscripts, in spite of the fact that they look different. Now, again, the competence issue. Here we have the Ein Sin Ye motto, which, of course, is Aisa. It's identical in structure with the other manuscript. This is an interesting one where we see a group of three bears following a lamb. So you see bear, lamb, lamb, lamb. And, of course, there should have been a ye at the end, because that, I'm sorry about this little slip. In both manuscripts, they are constructed with the same thinking. And the thinking is the so-called sloping twin mechanism. When two letters be follow each other, they are not equal in height, but the first one is taller than the second one. It happens in both of them. And if you have three, then the first is low, the second is high, and the third is low. It is exactly there in both manuscripts, discarding the stylistic differences. Now we reach the point of, I think, performance. Here we have the Sin Ye group. It's pretty well represented in this manuscript. I have it also in the first manuscript. And in both manuscripts, you can see that the people who wrote these scripts wrote almost like machines. They repeat the same forms in exactly the same proportions. Everything's the same. But all of a sudden, my attention was drawn by this. Now, you modern Lebanese designers think this is the normal thing. It's a scene in the year. But in this particular context, it is strange. It's the only one in a pack of 80 pages that I got that has it. And I therefore confidently consider this an error. Has an element of arrogance, but I think this is an error. Now, I look at this page. Here I found it. And here's the other one. You see, they're all on the same page. Here's one. And here's the one that I think is an error. I've shown it to several people, and people think that the writer may have done it because of the elongation needed. That's what you thought?
No, I think it's a letter. It couldn't be an extra letter.
No, I am confidently navigating on the Cairo grid, and I know that there should be Sin Ye and nothing else there. So that helps me to nail down the possibilities. Mm-hmm. So no, this is two ways of doing Sin Ye, one grammatically and one according to a different grammar. Well, the interesting thing with grammar is that you can always make errors without losing the information. Most grammatical errors are very forgiving. Now, I found something else. I have a ta followed by a ye, which is now horizontal, in spite of the fact that I had originally concluded that ta ends in a vertical pen stroke, so it's vertical. And remember, I had so little material, and I have only now one example of ta ye in manuscript A and one in manuscript B, which doesn't give me the muscle to make any decisions, whether it is an accident, an error, or a new rule.
So this is an error too, the top and the end?
Well, it draws my attention because, you know, I always hope that I find a neat mechanism, and if I find an exception, I'm always annoyed. We cannot tolerate exceptions. But anyway, so what I'm seeing here is an inconsistency. I can't resolve this issue. So I'm looking for more, and I remember that I saw that as a vertical one. This was the one that forced me to conclude that the pen stroke order was apparently reversed in this work. So it's not visually the last one of of Ein, but graphically the last one. But now I get a totally new image. So now I'm starting to doubt. I have now three instances in the second manuscript where the verticality rule is not as neat as I wanted it, which of course is very important when you build a database of reference for building an automated smart font, because the font will have to behave the way that I see, I think it behaves. Okay, now I'm going to look for more evidence, and thanks to my spreadsheet, I immediately spot the second meme, Ein, Je, Group. And guess what? Horizontal. Now this is evidence. And then, what has the meme to do with this whole story? So forget the meme, I'm only interested in anything that has Ein, Je. And then we have this. So basically, the grammar of the second manuscript is different. And that's exciting. I mean, that's the sort of thing that I find exciting. And can grammar change? Well, I've looked at another aspect of these manuscripts, which I will not go into detail here. But this is the word, the letter group, Sad, generic Fa, and generic Jim. And in the other manuscript, it looks like this. Remember the hairpin observation? That the Jim has a horizontal tail that has the same hairpin as the connection between Ba and Ye in both manuscripts. But here, remember the observation that the rounded form that is meme or Fa is expressed by vertical position in the first manuscript, and in the second manuscript it is lifted above the baseline, and it's still above the baseline. Basically, the whole thing is analogous. There's one difference, that the connection between the Fa and the Jim is horizontal in manuscript A, and it's vertical in manuscript B. Horizontal, vertical. So now I'm getting excited. I'm bringing in some more artillery. I found with my spreadsheet more examples. This is the same. This is a generic a lamb, a generic B, a generic G, Jim, and a W in both cases. Interestingly, there is an element of elongation involved in the second manuscript, but I'm of course only interested here in the relation between the B and the Jim. And you see it's vertical. So the one is vertical, one is horizontal. And that's interesting from a typographical point of view, because we have the verticality, horizontality discussion. You have the simplified Arabic that has no longer a vertical connection for the gene. And here you see both. One manuscript has vertical, one has horizontal. One more. There's going to be a small... Yeah, here is a wow in final position, and here a ra in final position. In all other respects, these constructions are identical, which again is telling for the penmanship. In both manuscripts, these people wrote like machines. And if you think of early Islam, these are 8th, 9th century manuscripts, it's hardly believable that this was done by Bedouins who were trying to get to terms with civilization. This is an expression of deep and long-lasting experience. Again, vertical horizontal connection. And now I found something else in the second manuscript. This is the Sad Jim Ra group. And I also found it in this form. Now remember that the horizontal connection was part of manuscript A. The vertical connection was typical for manuscript B, but now I found a horizontal connection in manuscript B as well, for the same letter group. Which means that the scribe had knowledge of both systems in the case of B, whereas in the case of A, there's only one system present. So my conclusion is that manuscript B is newer than manuscript A, and that manuscript A was done with someone who had a double, who was familiar with more than one system. So in all respects, this is the same hand. The construction of Ra is totally the same. And you see here on this page, for instance, this is Lam Ein Jim Lam. Here you have Fa Jim Mim Ain. Sorry, Mim Jim Majma. Mim Jim Mim Ain. So actually, everywhere in this manuscript there is a vertical connection, where there would be a horizontal one in the other manuscript. Mim Jim. Again, here is another one. This is Lam Ba with an elongation to avoid the tail of the previous letter block on the previous line, and a Jim and a Ra. And then all of a sudden, this strange exception. So this is why it pays off to look at old manuscripts. Now, my conclusion is that... No.
Okay.
Well, my lawyer tells me always to say no and undo it.
I was saying that maybe it is because it's at the end of the line, that maybe for justification purposes he was doing that?
No. It's a way of looking at it, but you can rule it out. There, he has so many devices inside the line to get there. They're not, and you don't see the grammar change because of this. No, it's not it. My summary is this, that I see shapes of analogous allographs in being stylistically different. So I have this manuscript A from Sana has an unconnected yet, which I haven't shown, but it's identical practically to the horizontal yet. And it has a vertical yet, and the Mingana has the same functionality, only the shapes are different. And for that reason, I think they are comparable. Then I discovered, and I haven't taken you through all the steps of the discovery, but this is, let's say, one chapter of a book about early Arabic script. There is a sevenfold allograph system in place in a manuscript A. There is an initial jim on the right. There is an initial jim that is preceded by a narrow letter, a bet or a lam, which takes it from the top. That's also already a vertical connection, but all other connections are horizontal. And then you have, so if in second position there were a mim or a sad, it would sit next to it and not on top of it. So only the letters that are one pen stroke wide would sit on top if the jim is in second position. If the jim is in third position, also the narrow letters would sit next to it and not on top of it. Then this is really like a grammar. It becomes an interesting text. How this works, as I end up with seven forms, and the second manuscript, the Mingana manuscript, has a simplified pattern. It has only four shapes, but all of them connect vertically. There's only one rule, top to bottom. Now the conclusions are, as far as I'm concerned, Sana has a fully consistent system of complementary verticality and horizontality for both Y and G. So what I mean here is that if there exists a vertical and a horizontal allograph for the same function, you find the vertical ones in an area where you will never find the horizontal ones, and vice versa. They rule each other out. They are in complete complementary distribution. But you remember the scene, yeah, example. They were overlapping in distribution. And therefore, Mingana grammar shows signs of disintegration of the Y verticality. They're losing it. The verticality-horizontality contrast is not maintained in the way it was maintained in the other manuscript, while the Jim has lost all horizontality. So, for you as users and designers of modern script, the whole concept horizontality, verticality probably never occurred to you. But if you look at the old manuscript, it's a very functional dimension of Arabic script. And therefore I thought it was great fun to do this as the last lecture. The differences, let's say the similarities point at two closely related Arabic script grammars, Whereas the differences point at consecutive stages of evolution, if you see what I mean. And I have already revealed that I think that one is older than the other. And now I have a small typographical postscript. If I am correct in assuming that pattern A with horizontality for gene and verticality in complementary distribution is replaced by pattern B with only verticality for the gene, then that remains the case in Arabic script tradition until the arrival of typography. It's a Western invention to reintroduce the horizontality. And it might even explain why Western typography was initially not embraced in the Middle East, because it makes taking the verticality out of the writing of the script completely changes its appearance. And it's very possible that to this day, I think Western typography totally underestimates the artistic and cultural implications of foreign imposed simplification. We have an institute in The Hague which trains Arabic font designers, and the institute doesn't have any expertise in the field of Arabic. And the same is true for Reading, it happens in Princeton. It's interesting that another thing is here is maybe a clue about how this came about. This is a page taken from a Western grammar of Arabic. It is by Wright, Wright, H-D. It is on the desks of every Arabic scholar in the Western world. It's printed in 1880, 1890. It's a translation from a German book by a certain Kaspari in the 1840s, who essentially summarized all traditional knowledge from Arabic manuscripts about Arabic grammar. But he has a comment about the printing here, and he says, we have a problem with the gene, the generic gene. They have these, he says, that in manuscripts and elegantly printed books, many of the letters are interwoven with one another. So instead of making printing better, he says Arabic is wrong. That's basically what he says. It's very inconvenient for printers. And especially when, as in this book, English and Arabic are intermingled. And most fonts, and he uses the classic word "found" because you are working with fluids, have some device to bring the letters in line. And he gives this example of the stacking, where the stacking is not completely perfect. And you see there's a glitch between the second and the third one, and you see this horrendous construction here, which I have shown earlier this week is a half borrowing from Andalusian Maghribi manuscripts. And he is very happy with this newfound used in this grammar that is a totally new design, which has nothing to do with Arabic script grammar, where all the genes are put online. So I thought that is interesting to add that against the background of this analysis. And what's also interesting is to go back to the original German edition of the same book, which did not have the problem. So the Germans simply note that here is the gene ligature, and everything sits neatly stacked. They really go down vertically. And compare it with the same paragraph of the translated book in English. And finally, for your amusement, the only multilingual book really worth mentioning and produced in the Middle East is a gigantic Ottoman Turkish to English dictionary put together by Sir James Redhouse, where all the Arabic is printed without compromise in verticality of the gene. You see all kinds of exciting examples, like al-Hujuj. So that is why you should consider Arabic script grammar. And let me continue with a few images of a book that I've been working on where I try to apply, or let's say to answer Wright's comment that it is necessary to redesign Arabic because it is so inconvenient. First, all these comments that I made today, this lecture, is actually the Mickey Mouse edition of an article that I wrote in this book. It has 20. Here you see the graphic of the graphics of the Cairo grid at work, and here you see other articles where we have tried to keep each script, the Latin script and the Arabic script, intact. And this is my favorite page. Can you see this? This is a page where the Nastaliq is mingled, is intermingling with the Latin. And it, neither side is budging. The Latin is proudly staying in its own rhythm. And the Nastaliq size is not shrinking. It's not going horizontal. It's doing its own thing. And it works. You get occasional clashes. But basically, I enjoy to see the Nastaliq proudly stand next to the Latin without having to redesign itself. Here you see a parallel text where we are not trying to make the Arabic look like Latin or the Latin like Arabic. And there's some more of these examples. And these are all like this caption, where in the caption we try to get as close to the scripts shown in this amulet. And here you see some images of other articles in the book. All in all, it's about writings and writing. Kitabat wa kitabatha. That hopefully appears soon. So that is my talk.
Any questions?
Wanted. Wanted? Are you okay? Where is it? No questions?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, good.
I was wondering that, of course, we're talking several years of evolution where the script that we've been seeing has evolved and the grammar has changed.
Mm-hmm.
What is the line according to which we can decide which change in grammar is valid enough to be approved and considered part of our culture, and what changes, based on what can we disregard some change and categorize them as Western influences?
Yeah, what the word for Western influence, I have coined a term for it. I call it a typographism. But to come to the question, I think I am. I know there are many books called Qawa'id al-Khat, and that's why I do not call this the rules of calligraphy, because that's what I'm not what I'm dealing with. I'm dealing with Nahw al-Khat, the grammar of script. It's only beginning, so it's too early to come with conclusions what is valid, what is invalid. I'm actually in the stage of mapping them, and I think that each time that you have a script that is internally completely coherent, then it's valid. And let me give you an analogy. Latin in the 2nd century BC was completely valid as a communication system. Latin in the 20th century, in the 21st century, where it's called Italian and has gone to countless grammar changes, is, as long as it is internally coherent, completely valid. And to take another analogy, if you look at Fusha, well, Quranic grammar is a bit inconsistent. But if you look at later, the real Fusha, after Sabawai, of the great classic Arabic, that is internally a completely coherent grammar. If you look at Lebanese, the Lebanese dialect of the south, which I wrote a grammar of, it is internally completely coherent. It's a valid system.
Okay.
But as long as you don't hybridize, if you start to jump between Fosha and Armenia, then you become funny. And if you jump between Latin and Italian, then it becomes funny, or French for that matter. So I think that But that is more like a matter of intellectual hygiene. Nobody tells you to do it in this or that way. You know that in the way of Arabic, anything goes. But since I'm not an Arab and I'm struggling to get to terms with it, I have to maintain a degree of intellectual hygiene. And that's why I'm doing it in this way.
There was a slide in your presentation where it showed most of the page was missing, where you had you had superimposed the slide with the page from the Cairo Quran.
Oh yeah. That was actually the slide that I took as an example of how do you identify a slide, which I then repeated 140 times in my own time. Let me see if I get there. We're almost there. So I'm somewhere. I'm working my way through all these possibilities. I found it. I find the point of entry. Which gives me the first half of the file name, which is simply this sequence of numbers and letters. It corresponds with this position in the Quran in the real printed edition. And then I have, and this is for just I went too quickly through this, but this is what the 1924 Quran looks like. So here's the close up. And actually, the font used in our computer model is a computer model of this metal typesetting. Then I have here the slide. I have now enough information for both sides. Oh, you see the file name here on top?
Yeah.
It's coming. Wait. We want to go to your... This is the point of exit. This is it. Yes, this is it.
Okay. Does this show that, if I'm not mistaken, does this show that the old Quran had lots of verses missed?
No, this, you cannot draw that conclusion. The only thing that it shows is that from a bigger sheet of text, the scholar zoomed in on one particular corner because he was only interested in that particular detail. And do you know what interested him? Do you know what always what attracted his attention? Nakul and Yakul. He is not looking at calligraphy. He is looking at Yakul and Nakul. His fuses blow. He is educated in a traditional Western Orientalistic manner, and he has no doubt at all in the veracity of every traditional claim about Islam. And then he goes to Yemen, and he has a huge pile of Quran fragments, and every one of them contradicts one of his teachings. And so that's why he photographs it. And that's why I have to make such an effort to map it against the Quran, because he never did it with this particular purpose. The other reason why he took this Quran was that he was fascinated by its regularity. He considered it an extraordinarily well-executed piece of calligraphy.
But why can't we find the lighter typography in the manuscript?
You mean, okay, my Cairo grid, I use a copy of my Cairo grid. I paint all the text light green because it's not there. Then I start mapping images that I see. For instance, this slide, I only map onto I only turn into black what is black, dimmed green, what I actually have on my slides. And since the slide, if you take a random book, if you have a complete book, and you zoom in on this corner for a photograph, then you have only this much information documented, no more.
But
doesn't mean that the book doesn't exist. It only means that particular photograph does not show any more than the black bits on. Do you get the point?
Yeah. I get it when it comes to several words that they are out of the frame. But for example, in the last Arabic line, there's
I think you have a point. I took the word Elena as my last identification anchor, and I should not have done it. I should have taken a complete image rather than an incomplete image. Elena, in fact, for my research, turned out to be useless because I only have the top bit of it. I have only here a few vertical penstock. I should not have taken it. I should have stopped at the word nefs, which is here. It's
the one with the generic back,
generic fat, and the generic scene.
So we can conclude that the modern Quran is in line word by word with the manuscript.
On the basis of this particular set, yes. There, I don't think that I noticed any differences. But on the level, if you discard all the nuqat and all the harakat, because these are not part of the old text, and that is of course, and so that amount of precision, and on top of that we have this elaborate tajweed system. None of that is present in the old manuscripts. So the moment you strip it to the level that you can, in fact, represent it with this kind of transliteration, the moment you do that, you have found the level where most Qurans correspond with each other. This is the common denominator. So, in fact, it confirms an Islamic claim about the immutability of the Quran, but not on the level of the skeleton, but not on the level of the meat. But there are also manuscripts where the whole order of the surahs is different, or the order of the verses inside the surah. There is more than the eye meets. But in my particular investigation, I was working, and that was with a pretty precise correspondence with the modern edition. And since I was looking at the script and not trying to raise hell about the structure of the Quran, I was happy to do it like that.
What about the spacing between the letters or words?
There is no spacing between words. There's no such thing. There is continuous and discontinuous letters. There's final forms, and in each one triggers each a discontinuous letter and a final form triggers a spacing. These spacings are completely and absolutely identical. And you might even remember that I had an image where the same scholar used a compass to measure the distance between all the whites in the page, and he had a page where they were absolutely identical. Frankly, if I look at this page, I see slight fluctuations. I think that inside Fathum there is less space than between others, but in general, the space is no indication for word separation. And if you now go to Tasmim mimics that particular phenomenon. You can set the spaces inside and outside words identical, and you can make it very big so that you spread the text very lightly, very thinly over a page. In case you want to do a classical Quran edition. And that's why that was the bottom of this operation, is eventually to create a smart font that behaves correctly according to the rules that we glean from all these manuscript fragments with the correct interspacing. More questions?